With hundreds of aircraft now in service all over the globe, you're probably familiar with the HondaJet, a disruptor within the light business jet market because of its clean sheet design. See, that means Honda engineers took a look at the conventional approach taken by other light jets and said something like, yeah, okay, but we can do better than that. They created a unique aircraft with superior aerodynamic performance and efficiency. An accomplishment achieved through many innovations, but one of those being a design breakthrough so visually striking that the HondaJet stands out from anything else in the sky. That, of course, being the over-the-wing engine mount. So, why are the engines mounted over the wings? Hey, good morning, Chris.
Good morning, Josh.
How's it going?
Good, good.
What you got going on today?
I'm gonna take a ride to Dallas, then taking a look at some weather, make sure that we be able to get over it.
Yeah, what is that topping out?
Tops are about 35, but for the HondaJet, up to 43. Gonna go right over it, zero issue.
Okay, so back in the 80s, Honda had already made a respectable name for itself all over the globe. They had applied their engineering prowess to find their way to the top of just about every racing podium that they sought after, all while making vehicles and production processes that made personal mobility accessible to everyone. We're talking vehicles so good that they quickly became a symbol of dependability to everyone around the world. By 1986, Honda had achieved decades of innovation, both on land and water. So the leadership in Japan wanted to explore the idea of spreading their wings into aviation. But how could Honda apply their proven record of innovation into a thoroughly different industry? Well, first they set forth a mandate listing key improvements to existing aviation designs that they would need to meet or even exceed in order to make the immense research effort ahead worthwhile. First item on that list takes us back to the late 50s when the jet age was booming as the military had begun using newly designed small turbojet aircraft to transport top officials. Soon, the private sector, realizing the luxury of fast and on-demand travel, caught interest. In the early days of private jet transportation, a standard design emerged, one that would become prolific for decades to come. Manufacturer after manufacturer would follow the same unchallenged convention. The engines of these jets were always attached to the fuselage in the rear of the aircraft. Innocuous at first glance, but an absolute pain when you realize that the real estate within an aircraft fuselage is at a premium. Here's what we're talking about. This is an admittedly crude example of an aircraft's fuselage and its engines, which in this case are attached directly to the fuselage. But let's take a look inside. Right here is the rear wall of the cabin area, and then this is the forward wall of the aft cargo space. So this is for people and this is for cargo. Now in between them is this structure right here tying the two engines together. See, it's not just that the engines are stuck to the outside of the airplane. This design requires this structure tying them together and then harnessing all of the thrust coming from the engines into the framework of the aircraft. But if we remove the engines, and then remove that structure, we also find all kinds of systems that go along with the engine. So we've got electrical and plumbing because of fuel, we've got like cross-feed pump, more tubing because of bleed air systems, and more electrical. Once we get rid of all of that, we can take these two walls and move them much closer together. And this is what the Honda engineers identified as being the first priority in improving the efficiency of the aircraft, gaining all of that space. If you remove the engines and their systems from the fuselage altogether, then that means more room for cargo here and more room for humans here. Welcome to the Honda Aircraft Company production building. This is where all the new Honda jets are going through assembly, including this brand new fuselage early on in its assembly, which is great because no wings, no engine, no pylon yet, which gives us good access to be able to show you what we just looked at with the model where those two walls came together. So right here, this represents the forward wall of the aft cargo. And then right here, this represents the rear wall of the cabin. So those two walls coming together because there's no engine attached to the fuselage and no structure going through the fuselage, that all that space is gained, and those two walls are only that far apart. Now, in the future, there'll be a fuel bladder mounted in here as well, but those two walls are only that far apart, greatly increasing the space in both the cabin and the aft cargo, as well as better access to aft cargo. So instead of having a small door located underneath of this big engine attached to the airplane, we have much better access, a big giant door leading to a cavernous cargo space. Check this out. I mean, look at all this space. There's no structure or systems coming through the airplane, just making this space giant, which means you can load up your gear, your golf clubs, all of your bags. I mean, just about anything.
That large door sliding out of the way and leading to 57 cubic feet of space in the back of a light jet is something overlooked by some, but pivotal in terms of aircraft usability. You just don't want to think about what you can and cannot bring with you, and in this case, you rarely have to. But let's check in and see how it's going.
Loading some bags there.
Just doing the best part of any pilot's job, loading some bags.
Pretty easy to do, though.
And the HondaJet, it's a breeze.
Cool. The Honda engineers have freed up all of that space inside the fuselage, which is great, but where are they gonna attach the engines? See, these power plants with their thousands of pounds of thrust need a secure place to attach to the airframe where they can impart all of that power and send the aircraft pushing through the air. So what about below the wing? Well, not on an aircraft of this class, because there simply isn't enough ground clearance under there. Plus, they might end up ingesting all kinds of ugly stuff coming up off the surface. So if not under there and not attached to the fuselage, where do they go?
Well, over the wings, right? Obviously, but it's not that simple. The Honda engineers were well aware of the many complex aerodynamic hurdles and headaches created by locating anything over a wing, which is where the shape of the wing is doing most of its work.
Adding to the complexity, the HondaJet designers were developing a natural laminar flow wing. That's a surface that avoids turbulent airflow and the drag that comes with it. One obstacle to that is that at high speeds, that efficient flow begins to deteriorate as the turbulent air works its way back into the equation. However, Honda engineers believed that if they could find the perfect engine placement, they could actually use the airflow around the engine to prevent that turbulent air from forming. And that would enable the natural laminar flow to remain viable even at the really high speeds. And thus began years of research and development using complex computer models to find that perfect relationship between wing and engine mount for those breakthrough efficiencies. After running several hundred computer simulations where they moved the engines up and down and forward and aft, as well as extensive hours of wind tunnel testing, the Honda engineers were able to identify just the right positioning of the engine nacelle relative to the wing and prove their hypothesis by achieving positive aerodynamic interference achieved through optimal interaction of flow fields, greatly reducing upper surface shockwave strength and increasing the drag divergence Mach number. All right, so a quick breakdown and you'll understand what all of those really big words mean and why it took years to get here. So the magic at work when a wing creates lift happens here, where the air is forced to travel faster along the top of the wing than it does below. This creates a low pressure area on top, and nature wants to fill that vacuum so your wing goes up and you go flying. But physics fights back. And as the aircraft begins moving faster, the air along the top of the wing begins crowding, creating a region of compressed air, forming what is known as a shock wave. This shock wave, along with turbulent air forming behind it, causes drag. Not something you want in an aircraft as fast and efficient as the HondaJet. Here you can see the effects of the shock wave and turbulent air growing larger as the speed increases. These speeds eventually reach what is known as the drag divergence Mach number. This is the point in which drag begins to increase exponentially, meaning for every slight increase in speed, drag increases significantly. This effectively creates a max speed the aircraft can operate efficiently. Enter the over-the-wing engine mount. The Honda engineers proved that they found just the right place where the air flowing around the engine nacelle will help reduce the effects of the shockwave and increase the speed the aircraft can travel before hitting that drag divergence Mach number. They call that little trick there positive interaction of flow fields.
Now that they figured that out, the precise location of the engines can be maintained and the power of their thrust is harnessed by securing them atop pylons attached to the wings. Wait, what's a pylon?
This pylon structure is something that you are more familiar with than you might think. Like on a commercial airplane where the engine is mounted below the wing, you have an engine mounted to a pylon under the wing. But if you take this concept and you flip it to the top of the wing, like on the HondaJet, similar structure, different configuration. And the escape from convention has an added benefit. It creates a literal detachment from the standard light jet fuselage mounted system. These engines, with their massive amounts of thrust, are separated from the walls of the cabin.
It means when you're in the cabin up here at cruise, just enjoying your coffee and having a chat about that pickleball game, those engines outside are turning liquid into foot-pounds of force in a violent and beautiful symphony of compression and combustion.
Now, the engines on the HondaJet, developed through a partnership between GE and Honda, are the quietest version of a violent and beautiful symphony that you're going to find on this class of aircraft. But some noise and vibration are an inevitable byproduct of sending you down the runway and up to cruise at 422 knots. So what happens when this source of thrust and vibration is connected directly to the fuselage with a short and rigid structure? Well, let's take a look inside. Much of that vibration is absorbed directly into the space where you are sitting and you're just trying to enjoy your coffee. Now let's isolate the engines and separate them from the fuselage. Place them up on pylons over the wing and attach them to the long wings, introducing plenty of structure where vibration can be absorbed and dissipated away from the fuselage, away from you and your ears and your coffee.
Honda entered aviation the same way they approach any other arena, with an intent to innovate and push the limits of what's possible. Through challenging the firmly set conventions, Honda made their mark on aviation, taking a totally new approach for a light business jet. This is another step in the ongoing mission of Honda, to continue to innovate and change the way we view personal mobility. That spirit is alive and well at Honda Aircraft Company, where we are reimagining the future of light jet transportation.